गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। सो हाउ आर यू डूइंग गाइस? ओके, सो लेट्स गेट स्टार्टेड। लेट मी शेयर माय स्क्रीन गाइस। बिफोर वी एक्चुअली गेट स्टार्टेड, डू वी गाइस हैव एनी डाउट्स इन व्हाट एवर द क्वेश्चन वी हैव डिस्कस्ड सो फार? एनीथिंग एनीथिंग रिलेटेड टू द क्वेश्चन? ओके, यस्टरडे आई आस्क यू टू डू वन एक्सरसाइज। डू यू गाइस फील दैट देयर वर सम टॉपिक्स दैट वी गाइस आर मिसिंग आउट? If do, let me know, right? So we can plan in that manner. Right? As far I know, we have covered most of the topics, but yeah, we might miss out something. And I really don't want to miss out any of the topics in Java. So that's the reason why I have asked you to go through once, right? If you feel like, even in the next class, if you feel like that there is some topic missing, right? So we can plan in that manner in the upcoming sessions. Right. Okay, great. So yeah, let's just open the link and try it out. Okay guys, so yesterday we have started discussing exception, right? But we haven't finished it yet. So in the today's class, we will try to cover as much as we can, right? After that, we'll be taking some MCQs as well on the exception itself. So that we'll cover the MCQs along with, because mostly the company is not going to ask you to write a competitive program on the basis of exception, right? It would gonna be asked in the terms of an MCQ, so that's why our major focus will be on the MCQ. But before we actually jump into the exception, I have some problems to be discussed. So let's try it out with some problem and then we can move on to that. Can you guys try to read the question? Okay, and do let me know whatever the solution comes to your mind, right? Just let me know so that I can rectify at the same time that, okay, this might work, this might not work. Question is quite straightforward. Using hash map, we should create non-repeating arrays, then write substring. Okay. Okay, so you mean considering all the substrings, right? Considering whatever the possible substring, then or maybe you will just collect out whatever the different characters we have, and then you will form a string, is it? Okay, but keep in mind we need to form a substring, right? So it cannot be the alternate numbers, right? You cannot skip out any of the characters if it is coming in between. Okay, how about others? Okay, firstly finding all the substring, then each substring, checking if the frequency is one for all the characters, then storing its length. Okay, well, good enough. Okay, convert the character array to an int array, okay, and then store the difference between the adjacent number. How it gonna help you in finding the longest substring? Okay, so let's get started. So what exactly the question says is, given a string s, find the length of the longest substring by using hashtag. Correct, it can be done, but how will you keep track, right? There are the two cases, right? So the first case is, that should be a substring, that cannot be a subsequent. When I say substring, it should always be in the continuous order. So let's say if I started from G, right? If I started from this G, I can only take G, E, E. Okay. So G, E, E is again not possible. Then I cannot take any one of those, right? Then I need to again start from E. Again, I'm getting E. Then I need to again start from E, this E, and check it out each and every time. Okay. So what exactly we need to do is, for each and every substring, we need to find that if the character frequency is one or not, right? So that can be done with the various ways. First way, you can use a hash map, right? The second thing you can make use of, or maybe you can use a hash set as well for that, right? Just to check whether there is a repeating character or not, right? You can make use of a hash set. If it's a repeating character, you just need to reject that, right? So you just break the loop and it will work as simple as hash map, right? Because anyways, we don't have to store the count. Right, so the hash set also works. We can make use of an array as well to count the numbers. Okay, how can we make use of an array to count the numbers? So I will give you one more instance, right? Those who doesn't want to use hash map, but I am not saying this is an efficient approach. Sometimes this approach doesn't look good, right? And this approach might not give the expected time complexity, but I'm just telling you a way. There is a one more way to calculate how many times a particular character is getting repeated. Right, so I'm going to create an array. Okay, that array is basically of 26 numbers. New int 26. So what exactly I'm gonna do with this 26? Since I know there are the 26 alphabets in from A to Z, so what I'm going to store is, I will consider that A as 0. Right. So whenever I got A, right, I will just go to that index. It's basically the same kind of a same working as of a hash map, but instead of using a hash map explicitly, we are using an array, right? right, to get the functionality of a hash map. If I got B, I will go to the one index and fill out, right? So the B should be at the one index. Similarly, the Z should be at the 25th index, right? So let's say I got G, right? So there should be some index defined for this, right? You can calculate using the ASCII value. There are the various ways to calculate it, right? I don't want to go for that. But whatever the, let's say you got the G first, right? So let's say the G is at the 10th index, right? I'm just assuming that that might not be a correct number, right? So G is basically at the 10th index. You will go at the 10th index and put one over there, right? Because you encountered G. So now your array will look like all numbers zero as of now for the very first number, right? And at the 10th index, you will be getting one, and remaining numbers will again be zero, right? Then next number you encountered is basically E. So let's say E is at the fourth place. Longest substring means ASCII value should be in the increasing order. No. Longest substring. No, that's not it means, right? Longest substrings, when we say the length of the string has to be the longest. It's not related to the ASCII value. And there should be the unique numbers. Is that clear? Okay. Okay. If I say E, let's say, no, it shouldn't have the repeated character, right? Okay, A, B, C, C, B, B. Yes, it should have three only. Yep. Anyways, it has only three characters, so it cannot be greater than three, which is three only. It should be three. Okay. So let's say E, you are getting at the fifth index, right? So you will go at the fifth index and put one over there. Right? Then after that, you again got E. What you're gonna do is you're gonna make it two, right? So basically, at the end, you will be having a count of an each and every number which is present at the particular index. Right? So this is how it is going to work. Right? This is one of the way to calculate the count of an each and every character inside a string. Is that clear, guys, this approach? Still we haven't discussed the solution yet. What we have discussed, how to find the count. So for finding the count, we have two solutions, right? First one, you can make use of a hash map, right? Which we already doing it, right? Second one, using array. But can anyone tell me what should be the drawback for using an array? Right. Do you see any drawback for it? I do see one. Let's see how many of you guys can figure out. Well, the reason why I'm discussing each and every solution so that at the time of giving an interview, right, at the time of solving a question, if you got stuck with the one of the approach, right, you can always come back to the second approach. Okay, A, B, C, B, C, okay, whatever it is. So the longest substring is 3. Yes, it is. A greater than B greater than C. Okay, static in nature because it's size. That's correct. But what will be the cons of it, right? Will it take more time complexity? Will it take more space complexity? That's what I'm trying to understand. No, it really doesn't matter on the A greater than B greater than C. We just need to find the correct. So the array will be of fixed size. That I do agree. But do you see, will it give a wrong answer at any time? Correct, good. So it's going to take a more space complexity. The reason why is because these are the absolutely correct answer. There will be a fixed side, right? So rather than framing it like this, you should frame it like this, that it's gonna take a lot more time complexity. The reason behind that is, let's say I do have a hash map, right? The only element I have inside the hash map is just A, right? I just have a string which is defined as A. String str is equal to A. Now, if I ask you to count each and every variable, so inside this, you still need to make an array of a 26 variable, which is again a vestige of a memory, right? You actually don't want to use the whole thing, but still you have to create the whole array, right? Because you never know, the second string might come with which have all the characters, correct? So you never know that it might have some other characters from starting from A, B, C, D, E, F. Right, or it may have just A. So if you just have A, still you need to create an array of 26, right? And that the 25 are still the vestige, right? The 25 things I'm not using, but I'm still creating. What happens inside the hash map? Whenever you get a matching character, right, then only you create a one more row, right? If there is no matching character, you will just end up with having a one itself. So that's the one clause I see when we use a hash map. But honestly saying, there is not a lot more time complexity difference. The time complexity is more or less same, because anyways, we need to iterate the whole string or whatever the integer we have, we need to iterate fast. Okay, coming back to the question, let's have a look at the summation as well. So basically, I have done it using a hash map. But if you guys want, you can define an array over here as well. And do try it out. It's also one of the good approach, right? Not too big to say. Right? So what exactly I'm going to create is, okay, we have done it using a hash set. You can make use of a hash map as well, right? The reason why I have used a hash set instead of a hash map. So the second solution, if you have seen, right, we can make use of a hash set as well. The second solution is using hash map. But actually, I don't need the count of an each and every character over here. And hash map is also more space complex. Right? Because why it's a more space complex? Because we still need to store the key and value pair. We need key value pair. Right? If you need a key value pair, it's again going to take a lot more space complexity with respect to the hash set. If the things can be done with the hash set only, why do I need to go for the hash map? Okay, how exactly we are going to achieve it with the hash set? Because I don't want the exact count of each and every character, right? What exactly I need, whether it's present or not. And that can be defined with the hash set as well. Let's have a look. Okay. So I have created a hash set of a character. Right. And basically I do have a for loop. One to start from the each and every ith value. Till I have to go. And after that, I will just add the first number to that. So how this works, let's take an example as well, along with iterating. So let's say I have geeks. Maybe this is what we can take. So let's say I have taken the geeks as an example. The very first time I see, I encountered G. If I encountered G, right, I will put inside the hash set. So that will go inside the hash set. Now, h dot add caret I. So it will go inside my hash set as well. Now my hash set contains this. Hash set contains only the element G. Right? Now what I need to do is, I need to keep on iterating, right? But whenever I got a repeated character, I just need to break it. I don't want to calculate it anymore, because I got one repeated character and that cannot be the substring for me, right? So second character, I will start iterating from the E now. So that is why I have taken I plus 1. To the S dot length, we need to iterate J plus 1. Okay. So how exactly we're gonna check it? G comma then I got the second character as the E because it doesn't contain E. So I will increase my count to 2, right? Because the count was already 1. So the count value will become 2 and I will add this to my hash set as well. So now I got the two characters in my hash set. Now the third number is itself is an E, right? It will check whether it's present. Yes, it is already present. It will go to the else part. It will break. After break, right, I need to update my count variable or maybe the max variable. So if I have a condition, if my count is greater than max, right, update the max as well count. Right, so once you will do this, that's what we have done. So updating the count variable and at the end we'll print the max variable. When we go for the second iteration, we'll start from this E. When we go for the third iteration, we're gonna start from this E. Any doubts? Quite easy question. Nothing tricky in this, right? Quite straightforward. You can do it with the various approaches using a hash map, using a hash set, or maybe using an array. Anyone has doubt? Okay, if no, let's move on to the next. Okay, great. I'm unable to optimize. Okay. Optimize one code. Can you please help me? Which one it is? Okay. Okay, great. So no worries. We'll discuss this question as well, right? Maybe by the end of the class. Okay, you have some solution as well. Correct. So this solution might not work, right? The reason behind that is if you have a look at the time complexity, guys. Okay, maybe we can quickly discuss once. It won't take more than 5 minutes, right? Can you guys also give a quick read for this? Okay, by finding the length of the code and save it in an n variable, find the duplicate number of elements and subtract from n. Okay. Is this for this question you are talking about? Okay, for the non-repeating string. Okay. Okay, by finding the length of the code and save it in a variable, find the duplicate number of elements and subtract from n. So what do you mean by n over here? Okay. Okay. Can be done. I'm still not very clear with your answer. This is to do try it out. If you feel like it doesn't work, maybe you can ask again. Okay. Okay, given an array with an element, the task is to count the number of factors of a number x, which is a product of all array elements. So basically, what exactly we need to do is 2, 4, 6 we have. Okay, so the 2, 4, 6 is equal to the 48. The factors of the 48 are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay, whatever the factors they have given, whose count is equal to the 10. Okay. Okay, so basically, what exactly you need to do, right? You need to just calculate the count, right? That's the only thing you have to do. Okay, and if you have a look at your solution, correct. So you don't have to check it till the I got your mistake, right? You don't have to check it till the p by 2, right? You can still do it with the root of p, and you need to use the equality condition over there. I'm not sure whether do I have a summation for this or not, but right. So I will just tell you the pseudo code, and if it still doesn't work, maybe you can ask. But what exactly you need to do is first calculate the product. That's absolutely, you have done it correctly, right? Calculate the product. Similar question, I remember we have discussed once. Okay, now what you need to do is, let's say you got 48, right? Now, instead of iterating for the whole loop, what you need to do is, for int I is equal to 1, I should be lesser than or equals to, I should be lesser than or equals to the square root of n, right? Whatever the product you got, whenever I say like n, I mean by the product. Okay, whatever the product you got, you need to keep it inside it. After this, I should be incremented. Okay, and anyways, you need to find the sum of the numbers, right? So basically, what exactly you gonna do is, there is a edge case as well. I will leave up to you guys to determine. Correct. Square root is less than n by 2. Of course it is. Right? Isn't it? Try it for n is equal to 100. Right? For the bigger numbers, it's always going to be the lesser than that. Correct, right? So n by 2 is a factor. Of course, n by 2 is a factor, but we can calculate the n by 2 in the other ways as well. Let me tell you, right? Because if I have the 48, right? Let's say if I have the number as a 48, what are the factors of 48? 1 into 48, right? What is the second factor I have? If you remember, we have discussed the same question, almost. 2 into 24. Right? What is the third factor you guys see? 3 into 16. What is the fourth? 48 is equal to 4 into 12. Right? Fifth is 48 is equal to any other factors you guys see? 6 into 8. Now, if you guys see, after this, it's going to get repeated. What is the next factor you see? 8 into 6, right? Do correct me if I'm wrong. Right? Just keep on reversing these numbers and you will keep on repeating the numbers. So, instead of doing all these, right? Instead of adding first this and then this, right? So, what exactly you are doing over here is, you are adding 1, 2, then 3, then 4, then 5. Sorry, not 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, then 8, 12, 16, 14, 28. Rather than doing it like this, I will just do it till here, right? I won't go beyond it. And what I will say is, add this and add this as well, right? So what you need to do is, sum is equal to the sum plus the number itself plus n by i, okay? If I say n is basically the product, It's the product divided by the I value. So here you will be getting 1 plus 48, 2 plus 24, and so on and so forth. Right? So you don't have to travel till the n by 2 as well. You have to just travel till the square root of the product. Right? There is an edge condition. I will leave up to you guys. Right? You must need to handle it. Think about when the n is equal to the 100. Right? If you got somehow product as an 100. This is an edge case I am telling you. Maybe you guys need to just handle it gracefully. Is that clear? Whoever asked the question. Correct, because you are not handling the edge case. That's the only problem you are doing, right? Think about this edge case. You will be getting a 10 and 10 two times. Not really. Don't need to subtract it. First of all, you need to use the equality condition. Okay, if let me just tell you that as well, if you tried it that way as well. So if I is double equal to the product upon I. If I is not equal to this, you need to do this. Else, you just need to sum only once. Sum is equal to the sum plus I. That's it. It will work. If the square root of n is a factor of n, then of course it is, right? That's why we have checked out the equality condition. It's not less than, it's equal to, less than and equal to, right? Okay. Do let me know if it still doesn't work, right? But it should work. Anyone has doubt in this? Well, so let's move on to the next question. Okay, so let's see how many of you can suggest me the different approaches. I know the question is quite easy. Points is only one. Correct? So given a sorted array of a size n, I will leave up to you guys to read out the question and do let me know what do you think about it. Okay, the first approach I got, which is AI is not equal to the AI plus 1. Good. What should be the time complexity in that case? Okay, big of n. Okay, it should be big of n, right? Because anyways, we need to iterate the complete array. Is there anything better we can do? I'm not saying this is not a good approach. Of course, that is absolutely a good approach, right? Since the arrays are already in the sorted order. Okay, they are already in the sorted. You don't have to sort it. Correct. Binary search is absolutely a correct answer, but how exactly we need to apply the binary search? Because from the time complexity itself, it is quite clear that it cannot be done if you check each and every element, right? It clearly says that you need to find your code should pass the time complexity, which is log n. So this is the one approach, right? the one approach I can think it of, right? Using just by comparing the each and every element with the others. If they are not the matching ones, of course they are going to be they are going to only get repeated one time. But is there something better we can do? And how do we apply a binary search if that's the case? Okay, before applying a binary search, can you guys suggest me one more solution apart from just comparing the elements? There is a one more famous solution to such problems. Average. What will you do with the average? Okay, hashing. Okay, yep, hashing also works over here. Okay, good. Okay, two pointers. How are you gonna check with the two pointers? Correct, hash map and the hash set we can take. Okay, sum by two minus sum gives the output. Correct, hash map and the hash set are absolutely correct answer. Two pointers, of course, we can use it, but there is still one more approach you guys can think of, right? We have discussed it once. Okay, just think about how can we make use of an XOR operation over here. Okay, yep, that also works. We can do it with the two loops, but it is not an optimized solution. Of course, we can do it with the two loops, even it can be done with a one loop as well, right? So definitely that's not going to be an optimized solution, but still if you have, there is nothing wrong in suggesting that as well. Okay, so let me list down the approaches that we guys can think of. Then we'll move on to the correct solution to that. Right, the first approach I see, just since they have already said that they've given a sorted array, right? So we don't have to sort it again. They have already mentioned inside this. So if I just check if AI is not equal to the AI plus one, right? Whenever it mismatches, right, that's going to be my answer. If I tell you about the time complexity for the very first code, it's going to be big O of N, right? Because you need to iterate each and every number. Iterate each number. Clear? Let's move on to the second solution. Second solution is using hash set. But hash set might not be able to tell you, right? Because the one is already there, then you need to keep a logic as well, right? So hash set and some logic is also required to maintain it, right? To get whether the given number is repeated only once. So some logic is also required. That's also work. third thing, you can make use of a hash map. It's going to take a lot more space, but it is also one of the solutions. So maintain the count of in each and every variable. Maintain count. And these two methods, right? The method 2 and the 3 also works if the arrays are not the sorted. We are still not using the functional D of the sorted ones, right? So these two methods, why I'm ruling out as of now? Because these two methods, I don't see any advantage of being it sorted, right? Here, if it's not sorted, I couldn't have applied this logic, right? But here, this logic will work even if the arrays are not sorted. This logic will also work even if the arrays are not sorted. Okay, let's move on to the next. Right? Kind of a similar approach, but you can tell it as a different approach, two-pointer approach. You can make use of a two-pointer as well, right? So keep one pointer fixed. Right? Maybe you can start from here, first, second, right? And each and every time you increase by 2. So if you check, right, the 2, if you increase this pointer by 2, this pointer by 2, and check the numbers, whatever the percent, kind of a similar logic, what you are doing over here. Here, the fifth solution. Fifth solution is just take the XOR of all the numbers. Take XOR of all numbers. If you take an XOR of all the numbers, right? So what exactly you're gonna end up? You're definitely gonna end up with the 4 itself, right? What is the time complexity for this? Big of n. Still, you need to know, guys, it's going to be the big of n. Still, we haven't got our expected outcome, right? Because if we take an XOR of all the elements, still we need to iterate each and every element. Is it possible you skip these numbers? No, you still have to iterate each and every number, right? So that's again going to be the big of n. That's again going to all these solutions, whatever we have discussed so far, taking the big of n. Now, I don't want all these, right? What I need is the sixth solution, which is a binary search. Okay. Okay, so do you want me to distill the first logic? Let's start from the first. Anyone wants me to give the logic for this? Okay, do let me know if you need any one of the first top 5. Anyway, the 6 I'm going to explain now. I hope you can try all of these, right? Quite straightforward. You don't have to do much on that. Maintaining account, we have discussed a lot of time, right? The two-pointer approach is quite straightforward. It's just same as 1 and 4, right? Now, apart from that, using a hash set and the logic, what exactly the logic you need to keep up? Put a number, keep a check, right? If a number is already there in the hash set, deny it. If the number is already not there in the hash set, keep a track of it and print the number, whatever the number doesn't come inside the hash set. So this is how you can do using a hash set. How about the binary search? So let's discuss the last one. And do let me know if you want to discuss any of the above approach as well. Okay, we can discuss it. So a simple solution is basically start editing from left to right. This is basically they have already assumed that's in the sorted order. Right, just you need to check whether the array I is equal to the array I plus 1, answer is equal to the array of I, and you need to update the I value is equal to the I is equal to I plus 2. The very first solution. Right. The second solution, what they say is using an XOR operation. So using an XOR operation, what exactly they are trying to say? A XOR A is equal to 0. That's what we have discussed. A XOR 0 is equal to 8. So the idea is to find the XOR of a complete array. The XOR of the array is the required answer. And this again going to take a time complexity as a big of n, right? So if you have a look at the time complexity, it's again big of n. Now, what is an efficient solution for that? Right? So the efficient solution can find the required element in the big of log n time. Okay, whenever you see a log n, right, the very first thing should come to your mind, how can I achieve a log n time complexity? There is only one way in terms of an array, right? either you need to somewhere you need to make use of a binary search, or somewhere you need to divide the array into half. If you need to divide the array into half, that means you are using a divide and a conquer strategy, right? If you have to use a divide and a conquer strategy, that's only possible with a binary search, because you want to search an element as well. Right? So what exactly this solution says? So this says, all the elements before the required first occurrence at even index 0, 2, 4, right? So all the elements before the required, if you have a look, right, 0, 2, maybe not this, this is not an ideal one. Okay, let me write one more over here. Right? Okay, if you have a look, right, so the 0, 2, 4, 6, 8. 0, 2, 4, 6, 8. And the next occurrence at the odd element. So, next occurrence 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. Right? And all the elements after the required element have the first occurrence at an odd index and the next occurrence at the even index. Right? So, every element has an occurrence, even occurrence, right? So 0, 2, 4. And then at the odd occurrence, we do have the same number repeated. If there is some mismatch occurs, right? So we will get to know that, okay, there is some mismatch occurs, and this is what we are trying to figure out with the binary search, how exactly we should do it. Right? So let's say I found mid. How I'm going to calculate the mid? Mid is equal to the 0 plus, and the initial state 0 plus length by 2, and we need to do it recursively, right? Recursively with the half of the length. And this is how the binary search works. Binary search calls the function itself repetitively, right? So if the mid is even, then compare the array mid and the mid plus 1. Okay, if these elements are the same, right, mid and the mid plus 1 are the same, and mid is an even number. So definitely, if the mid is an even number, that's definitely going to be this, right? If mid is an even number and array mid and the array mid plus 1 are the same, so can you claim that whatever the number you are looking for should be on the right side? Right? If both the numbers are same, then the required element should be after mid, that's for sure. If both the elements are not the same, that means there is something happened before the mid itself. Is this thing make sense to you guys? Okay, so let me explain it again for those who didn't get, right? What I can claim is at the 0, 2, 4, 6, 8, I should have a number. With the corresponding odd index, I should have the same number. And this is how, if the numbers are repeated as well as in the sorted order as well. Okay. But there is a number which might cause an issue in that, if the numbers is not getting repeated. So if I just remove the 2 from here, right? Let's see what happens. If I just remove the 2 from here, can you tell me the length for this? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 9 by 2, right? 0. Plus length minus 1 by 2, that is equal to the 4, right? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. I got the fourth number over here, right? But the fifth number is a different. And these both the numbers are different. If both the numbers are different, I can claim that there is something I need to search for in this array, right? Not even included 5, something I need to search on the left hand side of this. If both the numbers are equal, let me just add in 2 over here and remove the 6 from the last. Right? The length is still going to be the same. But what I need to do is, I will still calculate. I will go to the fourth index, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Right? So I will check whether the 4 and the 4 plus 1 is same or not. If they are the same, then I I can assure you that that's going to be that what you need to search is on the right side of that. Is that clear? I know it's a bit complicated, but what exactly we are trying to reduce the time complexity. For every question, it's not necessary, but for the sum of the questions, you need to think that way as well. Okay, so basically, find the mid is even, then compare the array mid and the array mid plus one. If both of them are same, then the required element after the mid, else before the mid. Similarly, if the mid is odd number, then compare the array mid and the array mid minus one. Right? So you need to check mid and the mid minus one. Why do I need to check a mid and the mid minus one? Because if it is an odd number, I need to check whether the 3 and the 2 have the same or not. Right? So 3 and the 2, if they are the same, that means my number is on the right side. If they are not the same, my number is on the left side itself. Right? And the same thing you can apply to this logic. Have a look at the code as well. Have a look at this. I will give you a minute time to think about it. If you want, you can iterate in the meanwhile. Right? And do let me know if you guys still have any doubts. Is it clear? Okay, great. Okay, so this is what the solution is. Basically, what we have this return over the algorithm, the same thing we have written. Okay, so let's move on to the next. Okay, so let's get started with the exception where we have left. Okay, so just I will quickly go through the multiple catch exceptions, right? We have already discussed that a try block can have multiple catch blocks, but we still haven't discussed that how can we make use of that, right? So a try block can be followed by the one or more catch blocks. Each catch block must contain a different exception handler. So if you have to perform the different tasks at the occurrence of the different exception, use the Java multi-catch block. Points to remember. At the time, only one exception can occur at a time, one catch block is executed, right? So if one exception, one catch block. All the catch blocks must be in the order from most specific to most general. When I say most specific to most general, what I mean from this is, first we have written arithmetic, then array index out of bounds, then exception, right? So the reason behind that, the exception should always be at the end, right? Because the exception is basically I will call it as a parent of these. Right? So if you return it before, the child will never going to get a chance and they will throw an error. And that's called as the compile time error. Right? So if you write this catch block at the start, it will throw you a compile time error because that doesn't then it doesn't make sense to write all these, right? If you have written already the parent, it's always going to catch an exception. Then why are you writing these, right? All the catch blocks must be ordered from most specific to the most general. Catch for the arithmetic exception before each before catch for exception. Right? That's what we are trying to say. So can you tell me what should be the output for this one? Yeah, arithmetic exception. Yeah, good. Correct. So the answer is going to be the arithmetic exception, because here the exception occurs. A5 is equal to the 30 by 0. A number cannot be divided with 0, right? So that will catch this exception and print it as an arithmetic exception occurs. But we do have a system.out.println might not be visible from there, right? So this statement is always going to get executed because we have already caught the exception. Can we move on to the next? Or does someone have doubt in this? Okay, let's move on to the next. Okay, we do have 5, right? And I want to print the 10th element. What should be the output for this one? Correct. Good. Array index out of bound exception it will throw, because we are going to print the 10th element, which is nowhere exists inside the array limit. So it will throw me an array index out of bound exception, and the rest of the code is always going to get executed because we have already got the exception. Okay, in this example, the tram block contains the 2 exceptions, but at a time only 1 exception occurs and its corresponding catch block is involved. Can you guys tell me which one should be involved? Correct, good. So there are the multiple exception occurs altogether, but actually, when the assignment operation works faster, right? So 30 by 0 is going to get executed first. And when the 30 by 0 itself is throwing an exception, so it will print that arithmetic exception occurs and then print the rest of the code. Okay, let's move on to the next. Yep, rest of the code will also get printed. Good. We created null pointer exception over here, but we didn't catch it, right? So I'm not able to catch in the arithmetic exception. I'm not able to catch over here. I might able to, that's you guys need to tell me whether we will be able to catch it over here or not. And then we need to print the rest of the code. Correct, parent exception occurs. Good. Correct, because this is the parent class of everything. So none of them is able to, it will definitely be able to. Okay, what it should give me? (30/0). Ideally, it should throw an arithmetic exception, right? So what it should print it? Have a look at the code again, guys. We have discussed one more rule, right? before checking that, you need to check that rule as well. Okay. Okay, so the answer for this is going to be a compile time, right? If I have a look at the answer, it's going to throw me an error. Okay, the reason behind that is why it's throwing an error. We have already discussed that the parent should always be returned at the end. And here you have return at the parent at the first. Okay? Then why are you writing even these? Okay? They will never get a chance to get executed, right? So that is going to throw in compile time exception that the code that you have written is wrong itself, right? If you move these two lines on the top, it would become correct. But since I have written it after the exception, which is a parent class, that doesn't work. Clear? Why not the common task completed? Correct, because it's giving a compile time error, right? You won't be even able to compile the code itself. Right? This is going to get executed. If you haven't written these two lines, right? Just remove these two lines, it will get executed. But if you are writing these two lines, then it doesn't make sense. They are never going to chance to get executed, right? Is that clear? No, when you do compile, right? How the compilation works, right? It compiles the whole program. If your code is correct, then only it will go to the, it will tell you that your code has been compiled successfully. It's not like it's compiled line by line, right? If you have a function over here, it will call that function first. So it doesn't work like that. Is that clear? Yep. Okay. So another concept to be on the same page, right? So we do have a nested try block as well. How does a nested try block as work? Why do we need a nested try block? Sometimes a situation may arise when a part of a block may cause one error and the entire block itself may cause another error. In such case, the exception handlers have to be the nested. So we can do it like this, try block. Then we do have some kind of a statement inside this, right? Which is again, do we have a try block and which is a nested try block we do have, right? So this is how my try block looks like. We do have a try block first, then another try block is there. System.out.println is going to divide and it's going to divide the 39 by 0. But there we have caught an exception and which is going to print E itself. Now I do have another try block, which is basically a full length 5, and I want to print the 5. I want to insert 4 at the 5th position, which ideally should give an array index out of bound exception. That should print E. Other statement I do have, okay, and I'm going to catch the exception inside this. So what it should print it? Okay, that's reason. Yep. Can anyone tell me the answer for this one? Okay, maybe you can tell me in that way, right? Will it going to get executed? First, we are going to print the going to divide, right? Because we are using a try block. Then we call it an exception. Once we call this exception, we are going to print E, which is basically an arithmetic exception. Then after this, we call it another exception, array index out of bound exception. We are going to print E. After this, this catch block will not get executed. The reason behind that is Okay, we do have another statement that's going to get executed, but we have successfully completed this plan. This catch block is for the different one, so this is also not going to get executed. So the output should be this one, then this one, right? And then this one. And this one as well, because it's also going to be inside this. Clear? Okay, what is the finally block? Right. So we have discussed that we do have a try block, we do have a catch block. We do have one more block, which is the finally block. And how does it work? Finally block is used to write the important code, which are always going to be get executed. Okay, what could be the important code we have written inside it? No, if the code is wrong, that won't get executed, of course. It shouldn't throw a compile time error. If there is a compile time error, of course, this is not going to get executed. But if there is a runtime error, this is going to get executed. Right? That doesn't mean that your code is wrong and still it will get executed. There is no chance it can. Right? Clear? Java finally block is used to execute the important code such as a closing connection, stream. Let's say you are working with some S3K, right? And you need to initialize it, right? So this is an important part of the code that's always going to get executed before you work with the S3K, right? So that's where you need to put an initialization inside the finally block. That clear? Is always executed, it means whenever your code gets compiled successfully. Okay. Whether the exception is handled or not, even if it's not handled, it will still be able to. Right? So Java finally block follows the try or the catch block. Right. So what is the program code? Program code, is there an exception occurs? If doesn't occur, it will get executed. If occurs, right, there would can be the two cases. Is it handled? No. If it's not handled, it will still be executed. If it's handled, yes, it will still going to get executed. In all the cases, it is going to get executed. Okay, why use the Java finally? Right? So finally block in the Java can be used to clean up the code, such as the closing a file, closing a connection. Right? The users of Java finally. When do we need to use the Java finally block? Let's see how the finally block works. So what exactly we are doing? We are trying something in data is equal to the 25/5 system.out.println data. We are trying to catch the exception as well, which is a null pointer exception. If there is an exception occurred, we will catch it using a null pointer exception. We will try to catch it. It depends that we will be able to or not. Right? After that, inside the finally block, we have written something. Finally block is always executed and the rest of the code. Can you tell me what should be the output for this one? Finally block, okay, 5, finally execute rest of the code. Okay, good. Okay, good. Correct, so first it is going to print 5, right? There is no exception. So it's not going to catch any exception. That's not going to print it at all. After that, we do have a finally block. If we have a finally block, that's always going to get executed. So finally block will get executed and the rest of the code. Okay, what it should be now? when we say the finally block is always going to get executed, that I mean that whether the exception is handled or not. Finally block rest of the code. Okay. Good. Good. So error finally block. No guys, there won't be any error. The reason behind that is, if you see it carefully, right? Finally block is always executed, and then after that we are going to print the exception in the arithmetic. The reason behind that, why we are getting this, I guess there's something. Correct. Ideally, they should have written an exception over here instead of null pointer exception, because this is not a null pointer exception, right? And there is some mistake they have done. So let's see the Java finally example where the exception occurs and it's not handled. So they are not handling the exception itself. So what exactly should happen over here is, first they have the data 25 by 0, which should throw an arithmetic exception. That's what we have read so far. If we throw an arithmetic exception, we are not going to catch any arithmetic exception. So if we are not going to catch any arithmetic exception, finally block will get executed for sure, right? And if the finally block is going to get executed, they either should have one more line over here, which says basically an arithmetic exception being caught, or maybe the exception which is going to get handled over here. So the output should be finally block, right? This will not get executed because they are not handling it. So that's the only outcome should be there. Is that clear, guys? They haven't handled the exception gracefully over here because they see some different exception name, which is not going to handle the arithmetic exception at all. The null pointer exception occurs when a string is going to be a null and we are checking the length of that. Any doubts? Let's have a look at it over here. Correct. So here they are handling the exception as well. And that's why we got an handled exception. Then after that, it should print the finally block. And then the rest of the code should get printed. Any doubts, guys, in this example, in the case 3? Okay, quite straightforward. Okay, for each try block, there can be zero, there can be zero or more catch blocks, but only one final block, right? So the finally block has a restriction that it can be only one for a one try and one catch, right? There can be multiple catches, but there should be only one finally block, because the finally block is used to return the important execution, right? Let's say you want to write something, closing a connection or something like this. So You can write all these. Anyways, it's always going to get executed. So there is the compiler only allowed to write it once. The finally block will not be executed if your system calls system.exit. Okay, it will give a compile time error. Right? If you have more than one finally block, you won't be even able to compile your code. Okay? System.exit. So system.exit basically exits from the code and causing a fatal error, which is processed to abort. So only this is the only case when your finally block is not going to get executed. When you do system.exit before writing the finally block itself. Is that clear? Okay, great. So Java throw keyword. Right. Quite a small article. So what is the Java throw keyword? And when do we need to use it? Why do we even use it? So we can throw a checked or an unchecked exception. We have read. This is also one of the questions that people usually ask in the interview, right? What is the difference between the checked and the unchecked exception? So that's why I have provided you in the tabular form so that you guys can refer it and remember it easily. Okay? I'm just telling you because these are the things which happened with me in the past, right? So the checked and the unchecked exception, there are the few various questions as well that they do use to ask. Apart from that, these type of questions was being asked in the MCQs as well. They are not going to ask in the competitive program. But with the MCQs purpose, it's quite important. So the throw keyword is mainly used to throw the custom exceptions. We will see the custom exceptions later. Right? So how do exactly we see it? Right? Throw the exception, throw the new input-output exception, story device error. So if you have a look at this, this is one of the best example they have given, right? So if the age is lesser than 18, I do want to throw an exception. That okay, you cannot train. You cannot give an age which is lesser than 18, right? So let's say you want to vote, right? And you are going to write a code to the people who are going to vote. So you will say that if I have the age, if a person's age is lesser than 18, I don't want him to allow it enter at all, any credentials. I don't want him to entertain it. Right? So I will throw an exception. And how I'm going to throw an exception? It's not actually exception, right? What exactly we are doing over here is, ideally the arithmetic exception should occur whenever you have an 18 by 0 or something like this. But we don't have an 18 by 0. We are trying to throw an exception explicitly, right? And we'll say it's not valid. The exception in the thread when java.lang.arithmetic exception not valid. If you're trying to validate 13, if you try to validate with the 21, it will go to the else part and it will say welcome to vote, right? And will print the rest of the code as well. Is that clear? Okay, good. Okay, Java exception propagation. So an exception is the first one from the top of the stack. And if it's not caught, it drops call to the stack to the previous method. If not caught there, the exception again drops down to the previous method and so on until they are caught or until they reach very bottom of the call stack. This is called the exception propagation. As the name suggests, guys. I don't want to go into the technical term, but what exactly it means is basically you need to keep on checking whether is there somewhere we are handling the exception. If there is somewhere we are handling the exception, we need to handle it. Let's move on to the code directly. So what exactly we are creating? We have created an object obj name with the name of an obj, and I'm going to call a method number p. What exactly method number p does? Correct. What exactly method p does? P basically checks for the n. What exactly n does? N basically checks for the m. Right? N basically calls the m. What does the m does? M basically calls a method which is data is equals to 50 by 0. It throws an exception. if I throw the exception, what I am going to do is the exception will get propagated, right? So n, I have called it from here, right? P, I have called it over here. It's calling n, n is calling m, and m is throwing an exception. So the exception will come over here, will come over here, and will catch it over here. The exception is being handled over here as well. And this is how the exception propagation works, right? Because the n itself is throwing an exception. How is throwing an exception? Because it's internally calling an m method. And if it's calling an m method, it's going to throw an exception. Right, so we will say that the exception is being handled and it's in the normal flow. That clear? Good, exception handled, normal flow. Yeah, let's have a look at over here as well. The exception can be handled in any method in the call stack, either main, method P, method N, method M. These all are possible. So let's have a look at the example as well. Correct, device error exception handle normal flow. Okay, so here I want to tell you one point, right? Programs which describe the checked exception are not propagated. Here, if you see what type of exception we have, arithmetic exception. So arithmetic exception is an unchecked exception, right? But if you want to use a throw keyword, right? So throw is basically a checked exception. And the checked exception is checked exception cannot propagate from here to there, right? So that's a kind of a key point that you need to memorize. So the checked exception cannot propagate, and that's why it's going to throw you a compile time error. Correct. It's not going to even let you print back, right? Since it's a checked exception. And we haven't handled it over here. So that's not going to even propagate, and that's not going to even print anything. It will throw you a compile time error. Okay. Guys, these are some key points that you need to remember only. Even I can't help much on that. Okay, let's try out some questions before we actually jump onto that. Perfect. So I have returned some key points I have written over here. Okay, let's try out this. The remaining we will do once we cover the throws and the throw as well. What it should give. Okay, let's see. How about others? Yeah. Correct. So let's write out the option is correct, right? Because we do have an unchecked exception, and the unchecked exception occurs at the runtime, not at the compile time. So the compile time, arithmetic exception is an unchecked exception, not checked by the compiler. So the program compiles fine. see the following for the more details. That's what we have already know. Okay. Okay, that you can do. Try to answer it. Guys, please keep in mind the whatever the things we have discussed so far. Yeah, option B. Okay. Okay, let's see. How about others? I'm getting the answer and then option B. Do you guys agree with that or do you have some other option? Okay, option B. Okay, what we have read about the catch statement? Have a look at these classes, right? The base class is extending the exception class, right? This is the base class. Derived class is extending the base class, right? So this is basically a parent. I would call it as a child. Here we do have a parent and then we do have a child. Do you still stick to B or do you have some other answers? Okay, now I'm getting a different answer. Okay. Correct. So it's going to give me a compile time error because the base class exception is called before the derived class, right? The reason behind that is I have already explained you, right? This should always be returned before this. If I would have just changed the order of this, it would have perfectly fine, right? But since the order is different, that's why it is going to throw me an exception that the you need to write the derived class before. Right? That's what they have returned. Okay, let's try it out. Guys, these are the things you need to keep in mind, right? Okay, option C. Yeah. Yep. So what should be the answer for this one? Okay, option C. So most of you guys say option C. Let's try it out. Correct. So that's first we are going to print A, which is equals to 0. Then B by A, right? Before this, we got an exception that is divide by 0 error. And after that, the finally block is the one which always gets executed. Okay. This one also we can try out. गुड, करेक्ट, रियली अप्रिशिएट दैट. Correct. So this question looks complicated at the first instance, right? What exactly they are doing, but we don't even have to check it, right? So what exactly they are doing? They are writing an exception first, and they are writing an index out of bound exception. Options not visible. Okay. Do you really need an option for these? It's always going to be a compile time error. And the reason behind that is because they have written an exception first, and after that they are writing a compile time error. So, sorry, not the exception first and then array index out of bound exception. Yep. Okay. So, quite lengthy question. We'll discuss it later. Okay. Quite easy. Let's see how many of you can answer it. Okay, good. Correct. If you remember the last lesson, right, we have discussed this, and I have explicitly said that that was being asked in the several that was being asked by many of the companies, and that the answer is going to be the throwable itself, right? And if you, I guess I have attached a kind of a pie chart, not the pie chart exactly, a flow chart as well, which says the throwable is at the top, right? And the parent class is on the right side and the left side. Okay, what is the built-in class in the Java which is used to handle all exceptions? Handled all the exception. When I say all exception, that means checked and unchecked. Okay, so since most of you guys say it's an exception, let's try it out with an exception, but that's not a correct answer, right? Just now we have discussed, right? What is the super class of all the errors and the exception? If we do have a throwable, which is a super class of the exception as well, right? So definitely it's going to have some more advantage than the exception. Is that clear? If we know the throwable class, if you see, I'm not sure, very sure they do have a diagram or not. Maybe I can just quickly show it to you. It's there on the Java T point. Correct. So the throwable class. Can handle all the exceptions. Exception is a base class of this, is a child class of this, right? And the error is again one more different class, right? So if you want to handle these errors as well, that these are not going to handle by the exception itself, right? It can handle the checked and the unchecked exception, but these are the errors which are not going to be checked by this. So that's why we do have a throwable. And the answer is going to be the throwable. Any doubts? Okay, let's discuss one more question. We have discussed the nested try and nested catch blocks. Let's try to discuss this as well. Okay, maybe we can discuss it later because it requires a full exception. Okay, let's move on to the Java deployment. This one we have discussed. exception propagation we have already discussed. Okay, throws keyword. This one also we have discussed. Right. Guys, have we discussed this one? I don't think so. Correct. So let's discuss this. The Java throws keyword is used to declare an exception, right? It gives an information to the program that there is an error occur. So it's better for the programmer to provide an exception handling code so that the normal flow can be maintained. Right? So when do we use the throws keyword? In the simple words, the throw keywords is used to handle the exception. To handle the exception which might occur due to the programmer's mistake, or let's say you want to open a file but the file itself is not there, that might throw an exception. So we might need to catch it somehow. Exception handling is mainly used to handle checked exceptions. If there occurs any unchecked exception, such as a null pointer exception, it is programmer's fault that he is not performing the checkup before the code being used. Syntax of a Java throws. So basically, we do have a return type, method name, throw, and the exception class name. It should be an exception class name, then the return type, then method name, then throws. Which exception should be declared? Checked exception only, because unchecked exception under your control, so correct your code. Error is beyond your control. Right? You are unable to identify anything which is a virtual machine error or the Stack Overflow error. Okay? There is nothing much you can do about it. So advantage of a Java throws keyword. Now, checked exception can be propagated. That's what we have discussed, forwarded in the class stack. It provides an information to the caller of the method about the exception. Let's jump onto the examples. So what exactly they are trying to do? Right? They have a throws keyword. Then after that, whatever the exception they want to throw, they are writing it over here. So started from here, we first created an object called a function p. The function p itself calls a function n. The n itself calls a function m. And the m itself calls a function. M itself throws input-output exception, throws new input-output exception, and there is a device error. This is going to be a checked exception. Ideally, if we haven't handled it, it should not get propagated. But we have handled it over here as well. And we are writing a throws input output exception. So whenever we are writing a throws input output exception, what is the output it should give? Exception is being handled over here. No, this is not going to be get printed because we don't have a println statement over here, right? So it will catch the exception, which is an exception handle, and after that it will just print the normal flow. Any doubts? Okay, if you are calling a method that declares an exception, you must either call or declare the exception. You call the exception, handle the exception using a try class. If you declare the exception, specifying throws with the method. So there are the two ways. You call the exception, handle the exception using a try catch block, or throws with the method and you declare the exception. So here we have declared an exception that might throw an input output exception. And after that, we are catching it over here as well. And after that, we have cached it. Right? So you handle the exception explicitly. So what we can do is, I'm calling a method m, right? Created an object for m class, calling a method. The method itself throws an exception. It might throw an exception, right? Whenever it throws an exception, it's going to catch it over here and it is going to call it as an exception handled. And after that, it is going to get printed in normal flow, right? Nothing new in that. Just we have returned a throws keyword. And after that, what kind of a input output exception it is. Okay, if you declare the exception, And if the exception does not occur, the code will be executed fine. Let's say you declared it as an exception, right? And the exception didn't occur. So that's okay, right? We still got our outcome, right? We are not going to print it. So what exactly happens over here is I'm calling a m.method, right? And the m.method doesn't throw anything. So my code will going to get printed this and it will print this. So this is basically a safe check, right? If there's something was wrong, it will ready to handle it if you do have a try catch block. If it doesn't go wrong, right, it will automatically work as expected, whatever you want to have. Okay. If exception occurs, so let's say if there is an exception occurs and mm is equal to the m dot method, then it's going to give me a runtime exception. So what exactly happened? Program if exception occurs. So void method throws input output exception, throws new input output exception, device error we have. We are not going to print it. But after that, we have returned a throws input output exception over here. We have declared an exception over here. After that, we are not going to catch it. Right? If we are not catching it, it's again going to throw me a runtime exception. Is that clear? Okay, let's move on to the next. So what is the difference between the throws and the throw and the throws keyword? So there are the various differences. Java throw keyword is explicitly throw an exception. Throw is used to declare an exception. It explicitly throws an exception. It just declares an exception that, yeah, there might be an exception occurs. Checked exception cannot be propagated using a throw only. Okay. Checked exception can be propagated using a throw. We have seen that the checked exception we try to propagate, it throws an error. But if we have used throw instead of that, it might get propagated. Throw is followed by an instance, that means by an object. Throws is followed by a class name itself. Right? So if you see the throws keyword is followed by a class name. Right? Wherever you see a throws keyword, it's followed by the class name itself, IO exception, right? Apart from that, we do have an IO exception. Then again, IO exception. Right? So more or less, it's IO exception only, but we should have a class name over there. Okay, throws is used within the method. Throws is used with the method signature. These are the quite different things with the throws and throws. You cannot throw multiple exceptions. You can declare the multiple exceptions. For example, public void throws, and it can throw two kind of an exception: input output exception and the SQL exception. Right. So just to give a bit of examples over here. Void m throw new arithmetic exception, that is sorry, right? Java throw the example. So throw is basically with the class name, and the throw is basically with the method signature. So this is what throws works, and we can explicitly throw it. So this is what we do, right? Java throw keyword explicitly is used explicitly throw an exception, and we are doing that the same thing over here. Throw new arithmetic exception sort. Any doubts? Okay. More or less the last topic. We are almost at the end of the exception, right? And guys, what I can request you guys to all of you, go to learn all of these topics again, right? And try to do as much as MCQs, you can do it by today. Okay? Because the concept you have read today, and if you do the MCQs along by side, you will get the better grip on the concept, whatever you have learned today. So it would help you in the future. right? You are not going to even, you are, if you even don't get a time to revise such things, still you will be able to memorize, okay, this was the MCQ and I have done this thing. Okay, so this is the last topic, finally and the finalize. So final is basically altogether a different thing, but usually the names look like the same. That's why they try to differentiate between these. So finally, final is a keyword, final is a block, right? And finalize is a method. Final is used to apply the restriction on a class. Final method can't be inherited, can't be overridden, final can't be changed. Finally is used to place the important code. It will be executed whether the exception is handled or not. Finally is a block. Finalize is used to perform the cleanup processing just before the garbage collection. So in the Java, we do have an automatic garbage collector, which basically can be invoked by using the finalize method as well. And finalize is the method name. So final x is equals to the 100 we have defined. And if we again try to override it, it might throw an error. That is a compile time error. This is basically an instance of a finally block. And this is basically an instance of a finalize. So what exactly they are doing? They are just making it null. To clean up the garbage, right? To clean up the data, whatever the F1 has. Okay, any doubts so far? Okay guys, so you must be seeing a poll on your screen. I can see most of you guys have already answered it. So those who haven't, can you quickly try to answer this as well? Okay, perfect. So because what I'm trying to say is, because I need to conduct one more poll regarding the time complexity, when should we plan it, right? So if you guys can quickly answer it, I can do the next poll side by side. Okay, so I'm ending the poll now. Perfect. Yeah. So that's guys, can we try to answer this? Because I'm not sure what's your availability on this. So and if you might have to go for the extra class, it would only be possible over the weekend. Yes, I can do it like that, but I want like maximum participation because that is quite fair important topic, right? In each and every question, we need to use it. So I want like every one of you can attend it. It would be great. Okay. Yep. Yes, okay. Okay, so I got my outcome. So we'll plan it in that way. We'll plan it in the regular sessions only. I will spoke to the team that how can we plan it on the regular sessions, right? So they will inform about the timings. Probably it's going to be the same, right? We might need to extend some couple of Java classes, but that's how we can plan. Okay, guys. So we are good over here. Thank you.